Now, it's that time of year again when many people consider their physical condition and appearance and vow to make changes. All of that festive excess, the food and booze, the lying around in pyjamas all day takes a toll after all. My next guest, nutritionist Juliette Kellow, joins me to consider what might be done in January to lay the foundations for a healthier year. Good evening, Juliette. Thank you for joining us.
Oh, good evening. Thanks ever so much for having me. Lovely to be here.
Good, good. Now, what's to be done, Juliette, to turn us into beautiful, healthy people, even if we weren't before Christmas?
Well, I think the first thing to say is really we need to get away from all these restrictive, faddy diets. It's the time of year when we typically go all out for kind of starving ourselves, skipping meals, skipping lots of our favourite foods. And we really need to be moving away from that and start to think about eating, not just for our waistlines, but actually, more importantly, eating for our overall health. And it's an interesting one because there was some research that came out earlier in the week, which was showing when it comes to New Year's resolutions, we're still prioritising weight loss. Nearly half of the people of over 2,000 that were surveyed said weight loss was their absolute priority above other aspects of their health, so whether that's their mental well-being, whether it's their heart health with blood cholesterol and blood pressure, whether it's even their immune system, particularly at this time of year when we know that there are so many problems with coughs and colds and nasty bugs doing the rounds. So we really need to start changing the narrative and start thinking about eating for our general health rather than just our waistlines. And actually, the two go hand in hand. We found also from the research that there was lots of restrictive behaviour going on. So people were planning on cutting out a lot of foods that they considered to be unhealthy. So typically things like burgers, things like pizza, for example. But actually, from a nutrition point of view, people were also planning on cutting out foods which actually have some really great nutrients in them. So cheese was an example here. We found that one in three people were planning on cutting out cheese because they thought it was unhealthy. With my nutrition head on, actually cheese is packed with protein for our muscles. It's got calcium and phosphorus for our bones. It's got vitamin B12 for our nervous system. So really, it's about getting the balance right, not restricting our diet, and really moving towards eating more of the foods which are really great for us rather than cutting other foods out of our diet and restricting.
But Julia, it is true to say, isn't it, that we are an increasingly unhealthy, overweight, depressed population. Why is that? You know, social media, I've noticed recently, is full of images of the 1970s beach scenes where you cannot find a single overweight person, you know, in a beach scene of hundreds, if not thousands, of people. Where did it all go wrong during the course of my lifetime?
Yeah, it's a very, very good question, actually. What we do know is that our lifestyles have become far less active, so we don't have the general activity. And this isn't just necessarily about going to the gym. We tend to move less. We sit behind desks more often. Our leisure time a lot of the time is sitting down. And particularly we've had this, haven't we, for the last two or three years through various lockdowns. And also our eating habits have changed quite dramatically. We've moved away a lot of the time from cooking. We're relying far more on processed foods, foods which are very high in fat, high in sugar, high in salt. So I think what I want to do is to try and encourage everyone to move away from this kind of like, let's constantly focus on what we should be restricting from our diet, and instead start moving towards the foods that we should be encouraging people to eat more of. And this is a lovely message for New Year. Quite often in New Year, it's all about cutting out. This is about adding into our diet. So adding in things like fruit and vegetables, adding in things like the plant-based protein. So that would be things like your beans, your lentils, your chickpeas, things like nuts and seeds, adding more whole grains into our diet as well. So swapping the kind of like the white bread, pasta and rice for the whole grain varieties to add fibre to our diet. And that really forms the basis for a really great healthy diet. And also cooking more as well. So we have lost the skill of cooking in many instances. We need to get back to cooking because it gives us control. We can add more of those lovely foods in and cut down on sugar and salt too.
Bear with me, Juliette. Tonya, you're a chef. You're also, you know, someone who's very invested in general health and well-being. Why do you think we have metamorphosed during the course of my lifetime from a predominantly slim population to a predominantly overweight population? What's going on?
Well, I've just got to add that we are together in this because I'm a nutritionist as well. And one of the things that has changed is processed food and bad foods that are being sold as being good foods, and when they are really terrible for us. You know, you have these packets as low fat, but it's full of sugar. And we're being conned as a society. Unfortunately, we're not being educated properly on how to eat. And we should be eating a lot more protein than we're eating. All we're doing is eating carbohydrates. We're only going to damage us if we're eating a predominance of carbohydrates and not enough protein in our diet.
Julie, do you consider yourself to have a good diet? I mean, I'm very mindful of the fact that diet really means a lifestyle. It's not really necessarily just about what you eat. But, you know, do you consider that you have a responsible approach to what you put into your body?
Yeah, I do now. I didn't. That's the thing. And I agree with what Juliette is saying, is that we need to sort of get away from saying what's bad, what's good, and thinking that the 31st of December means at midnight we have to do something else. I think it is a lifestyle, and it needs to be about enjoying what you eat and cooking and enjoying what you put in and seeing it as a nurturing thing, eating, not just simply for fuel or for overeating. So it took me a while, though. I was in my, you know, 20s, I ate terribly, like most young people do. But now I think I see it as sort of looking after yourself to eat well, and I think that's important.
Tonya, I can't let this opportunity pass without bringing up the fact that you were Miss South East Britain Natural Bodybuilder in 1997.
100 years ago.
Talk about nutrition. I know, I think we have some pictures. We have the proof.
So that I must admit, this was an extreme kind of nutrition to get that lean. I was a natural. It was a natural bodybuilder. There's no drugs involved, and I was Miss Southeast Britain. Yes, a long time ago. That was quite. You had to be really on your diet then, because the whole thing is you're trying to build muscle and stay lean, which is the ideal. But for competitive levels, there when you're going to get on stage in a bikini,
amazing.
Oh my God, it is a little bit further than what your normal person needs to do to be healthy. That's the truth of it.
Juliette, you're still there, I hope.
I am.
My eldest son is very much about going to the gym at the moment, and my youngest son actually is following in his footsteps. And I didn't know quite what to make of the move. It was 2 or 3 years ago now, but as Tonya's saying, I'm sold on it now, because he is so attentive about his overall well-being. He pays a lot of attention to food. He pays, and not in any kind of unhealthy faddy way. He just knows where proteins are. He knows where carbohydrates are. He knows, you know, to prioritise cooked food against, you know, processed food and all the rest of it. So I think there is something to be said for what is definitely a fashion at the moment, for paying that kind of attention to the way we look.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, protein is such an important nutrient for maintaining our muscle. And actually, the other thing is, as we get a bit older, certainly we start to lose muscle in our 40s. Now, what we need to do is really be doing the exercise and the activity to maintain our muscle strength, but supporting that with a really great diet. And I think we do have in this society, we've got this feeling, particularly if you're going to the gym, if you are exercising, you have to have protein shakes, you have to have protein powders, when in actual fact, we can get more than enough protein, plenty, by eating sensibly, by eating a healthy, balanced diet. And we can go for the plant proteins, as I mentioned earlier, so things like your pulses, your nuts and your seeds have a good amount of protein. We can still enjoy lean meats and chicken. We can enjoy eggs if we want to. We can enjoy the low-fat dairy products, which literally just have the fat taken out but have everything else. So, for example, one great example would be to have a low-fat eat lean cheese, which has all of the protein, all of the calcium, all of the vitamins in, which would have the regular cheese. But you get that protein without the actual saturated fat, which we know
but
isn't great for our heart.
I think we've got to be really careful not to demonise good fats, because I think even fats and cheeses are good fats. And as we get older, as you said, as you get to over 40, you know, you try to start to atrophy muscle, and as you get older, you get sarcopenia. But the reality is that you have to have more protein, and plant-based proteins are all well and good, but that we don't absorb them as well. And as we get older, we don't absorb protein as well anyway. So I think you know, good lean meats and eggs are the best food in the world. I mean, we should just be eating more of them.
What's wrong with fatty meat, though? I keep on hearing, you know, when that aspect of keto, for example, you know, with this, you know, paying attention to consuming quite a lot of fat. You know, fat's had a bad rap, hasn't it? Animal fat. You know, at home, you know, we cook with lard, for example, rather than vegetable oils or seed oils or any of that. You know, I think fat as well as, you know, what's all this lean meat stuff? What about fatty meat?
We do have to be careful with saturated fat, though, because we do know that saturated fat does increase our cholesterol levels if we're having it too in great quantities. And obviously, high cholesterol is then a risk factor for our heart health. So we do really need to be...
Yeah, but you don't get cholesterol from what you eat, do you?
Well, you do sometimes, but I mean, seed actually... vegetable oil has proven now to be one of the most toxic things that we can put in our bodies, you know, and especially if you've had animals that are reared properly, because that's the whole thing, isn't it? You know, how the animal has lived, you know, humanely reared, for example, you know, wild boar fat is just as good for you as salmon fat. So, you know, there's so much confusion. I do understand people get very, very confused, but I don't think the alternative is to go for something that's been processed. I think it needs to be something that you've cooked from home and you've bought the best meat and animal products that you can afford.
That's the message. I'm running out of time again. Juliette Kellow, nutritionist, thank you so much. It's a fascinating subject about which I freely admit I could get quite obsessive, but thanks for your contribution this evening.